Good evening, I'm Micah Richards, and tonight I'll be talking about the space elevator. This is a current prospective idea of how to ease access into space. Our current problem with space travel, honestly, is cost and fuel, probably the two main things. If you look, these are the these are some of the statistics of previous flights. When you're trying to get any amount of weight into space, you have to have fuel to lift that object up. In order to get that fuel up into the air, you have to have more fuel for it. And so there's this constant increasing ratio. These statistics are specifically on the mass ratio to the mass fraction, which is how much weight the spaceship was versus how much weight the actual cargo was. And if you see the amount, it was roughly 2%. Some have up to 40%, or in airplanes have 40%. Most rockets are down lower than 10% of how much of their initial mass actually makes up into space as cargo. And so with the space elevator, the idea is to simplify that down and make it more of a linear as opposed to an exponential function to be doing that. The other problem, we have occasional failures. Rockets, slight malfunction anywhere in the process could cause an error. And another thing that people are looking at currently is the concept of black carbon, which is basically just a more, it's a form of pollution that absorbs sunlight about 100 times more than just regular carbon dioxide, which is okay if it's in the lower atmosphere, because rain gets it and it lands down back on the ground. But if we have rocket engines that are taking it up to the stratosphere, rain can't take care of that anymore, and so it ends up becoming a lot more of a problem. This is an example of one rocket launch that did not make it. It goes about 100 feet up into the air and then the entire thing explodes. You can see this isn't actually pollution, most of it's water, it's a cooling system, but the amount of resources that are currently going into this launch are immense, and all of it goes for nothing a few seconds later. The concept of a space elevator is not a new one. It was mentioned in some that video. If you ever read the sequel to Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, Roald Dahl actually expands that concept of glass elevator and considers it taking everybody up into space and all the adventures that they have there. So the concept's not new, and people have been messing around with it for a while. So the general concept of the space elevator, you'll have a platform on Earth or up in the lower atmosphere that you can easily access with conventional methods, airplanes, etc. Then you have an extremely long cable. This is one problem, and weight at the other end suggested to be either a very heavy satellite or some type of asteroid. Again, we're going to have difficulty pulling that in. Some people have been thinking about it. It's an amazing idea. If you can pull this off, it'll extremely cheapen the amount of effort, the amount of cost that's going to go into space, transporting objects into space. But we currently do not have the technology for it, and that's where nanotechnology is coming in. Carbon nanotubes are currently considered as the only thing that will possibly be able to make that cable. Right now, we're going to have to deal with the weight and the stretching of the cable as it's both facing the gravitational effects of the Earth, plus the orbit, and plus any weight that's going up and down the elevator. If a storm hits that cable, it's going to have to be able to withstand anything that's put up against it, and current fibers aren't able to withstand it. Most metals currently, if you look at their tensile strength, are in the just under 1,000 megapascals. Carbon fibers have been known to be up to 63,000 megapascals, and their theoretical potential is 300,000, so a few orders of magnitude over what our current materials are. The current problem with nanotube production is that we can't do it quickly. We a few millimeters at a time. Some progress has been made, though. They can get up to about 55 centimeters before they have problems. That's about a consistent thing. However, there is techniques that are being developed for connecting them together. So you can make a bunch of small ones, and then you can put them into a solution and bind them together, so you end up with a thread of several nanotubes together, and you can use that to coil it up and use that to hold weights. And that has already been done recently. If we're going to make an elevator like this, we're also going to need some source of power. And nanotechnology has held a lot of promise in being able to work with batteries, alternate sources of energy, and transportation for it. Current problem with solar technology has been that most of the energy is reflected back off the solar panels. If we are able to use nanotechnology to make small holes within a substance, more of that energy can be absorbed and converted straight to power. We also have insulation problems that are going to be happening with anything that's going up into space. Nanotechnology has been able to be used for that. Again, similar to the holes, we can absorb more radiation, but also it allows for new substances to be able to take that energy, convert it into electricity, which can be used going back into the power system, as opposed to causing cancer in the astronauts. Nanotechnology is also being used for alternate propulsion systems. I mentioned earlier that getting the asteroid or the counterweight is going to be a difficulty. There's a concept of using either nanogels. The more surface area to volume you have, the more efficient you can make a fuel. But also, if you can use nano-sized fuel, you can get a lot more power into a much smaller area. And so there have been various technologies that are being pursued in order to get engine more powerful and smaller so that we can get farther and reduce the mass to weight fuel ratio. And just in general, as nanotechnology, as we expand out into space, there are several different areas that nanotechnology can be assisting with. Once we get up in the elevator, we can use nanotechnology either to help keep equipment up and running, use that for exploration, for surveillance, be able to explore other areas without having to send people in there. And then once people are there, we can use that to make better equipment, better suits, more durable equipment for the astronauts as they're encountering more dangerous areas. So that concludes the formal part of my presentation. If there are any questions, I'm happy to.
Questions from the audience?
Yeah. What do you think the likelihood is of this happening?
I think it is possible, considering that they already have the ability to make thread out of it. Having a single carbon fiber going straight up will probably not be possible, but if you can use that thread, project that thread and convert it to a rope, it would be extremely expensive, but it's technically conceivable at the moment. It is possible to do so.
Yeah. How thick would the space elevator be?
That would depend on where it was, how far it was. There's a lot of factors.
This would be a geosynchronous orbit.
It would probably be in place around the equator so that it can stay in the same place.
Same place as Kiribati, as in moons.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. Fountains of Paradise, that was the Arthur C. Clarke book. That's the elevator in space. Yeah, check that one out. Okay. Other questions or comments for our speaker tonight? Question is it going to be an up elevator and a down elevator?
You can jump down.
You can jump back down, huh? Just kind of fall.
So at the end of the nano out of the elevator, there is a possibility of flinging stuff into deep space. What velocity would that launch probe that per se?
Well, the main problem with getting objects into space isn't getting them up there, but getting them to accelerate to an Earth orbit so that they can maintain the position. With the elevator, you would be accelerating as you were going up, and so once you're there, you wouldn't need to be launched. You could just get ready to go rocket ship in the launch. Okay. You'd already be in free fall for
ion drive or something like that.
It would be more timing to launch so that you could leave the space station in the right direction.
Okay.
So also, probably a stupid question, but with regard to the moon, how far is this light between the Earth and the moon?
Still a conceptual thing. We don't have the equipment to produce that cable, but we have the technology where we could start. If it was pushed, we could probably do this, but.
Do you feel it will be pushed?
I hope so. It'd be nice being able to ride an elevator as opposed to having to take a spaceship up.
Well, what would be the cause to it not being pushed? Why wouldn't it be pushed? what would be the argument about it?
We don't need to go into space. Short-term rockets are cheaper. This would be a pay a lot up front and have it cheaper over the long run. But that doesn't always work.
So it's about 36,000 kilometers to Geosynchus orbit.
Correct.
And to the moon is about 240,000 miles. So double that about to get kilometers.
So you'd have a good day.
You're still a long way from the moon. About a tenth of the way, maybe.
Progress is made in small steps.
But you could sit out there and mine the belt of those geosynchronous satellites that are all out there and dead, right?
Also, keep in mind you're already going in orbit, so you'd be able to mine some sports.
Did you two still watching this?
Yeah.
Hello, Dr. Pepper.
Okay. All right. Well, let's thank our speaker once again. All right. Thank you.